This conference will now be recorded.
Let me start my Jupyter. Jupyter notebook. Copy it and paste in the browser. What was the name? Python PySpark notebook. It was the notebook that we have worked on yesterday. Let me just comment all these guys. Let me start a new one, new cell. So from there I will try to program everything again. Fine. Okay, no problem. This is the Spark driver we have to create. You can see this. With this, we can create the Spark driver, Spark session builder, master local app name, and get our create. Let us just run this for once so that our Spark driver will be ready for us. Yes, our Spark driver is ready for us. And open this URL in a new tab, Spark application UI. It is a demo app UI. You can see this. The name of the app is demo app. Why we have demo app is here we have given the name of the app as demo app here. Okay, fine. Now this session, what we shall try to do is we shall try to read the data from an RDBMS and how to load XML files and how to perform certain basic data frame operations. We shall try to see in this session. Okay, fine. So first we shall try to read from MySQL. I have installed MySQL in my machine. So how do we read and what are the jars required and what are the stuff required for it? Let us see now. Okay, fine. When we are trying to read from MySQL, we need to let me write something like this: df underscore mysql equal to spark driver dot read dot format. The format is going to be JDBC. So Spark will read from NoSQL databases or databases using the format JDBC. That is, it will establish a JDBC connection. Okay. So why it is using JDBC connection is already we have discussed yesterday that the Spark is implemented in Scala, which is a JVM based language. So it uses JDBC connector to connect it to any database. Okay, Spark driver dot read dot format JDBC, and we need to provide certain credentials like a URL, driver name, user password, and some stuff is required to be provided here. Let's see that what is it all need to be provided here. Okay, so I provide one option here, option of the very first thing we need to provide is a URL. Sorry guys, URL. So what is the URL for it? Okay, what is the URL of the MySQL server that we are trying to read it? So generally the JDBC URL will be like this: MySQL colon double slash and the host name on which the MySQL server is running. Okay, so I call it as it is local host only for now, and the port number of the server, the port number of the server would be 3306. Okay, just to close this, sorry, Next, one more option. Option of, we need to provide the driver class name, driver com dot mysql dot jdbc dot driver. This is the driver name. Okay, this is the driver class name, remember guys. Okay, option of next, we need to provide username. To connect to that MySQL server, we need to have an account, right? That username we have to provide. Here the username is root only. And option of password, we need to provide password, but we should not reveal the password here. There are ways to hide this password. I will show you that later, we shall see that later, but just to understand the concept, I am giving writing the password directly here. That's fine. So URL, driver, user, password, and one more option, from which database and from which table. Okay, from which database and from which table, even that we have to specify. So right now we don't have we haven't got into that. So let's see why everything got color got changed here. Anything wrong? One second guys, I think there's something wrong here. It's not working. What is the problem? One second guys, just I will restart the kernel. If something wrong here, you can restart the kernel guys. Instead of restarting entire the process, you can just restart the kernel. Everything should be set again. What is the problem? Just a second guys, I will close this and relaunch it again. One second. PySpark notebook. There is some issue with this, so let me close this. So DB table, here we need to provide the database name and table name. Okay, so before getting into that, let me just see, let us go to MySQL server and let's see what are the databases and tables we have. So, and let us try to read them. Okay, so MySQL workbench. So this is the latest version of MySQL I have installed in my machine. Started already. No, you can see this one connection is already established with user as the root, and this is the host name and port number. Let me just click on this. Yeah, here we need to provide the password to start the connection. Yeah, this is what we have. So already there are some databases are there. If you want to see the list of databases, this is a command, right? Show databases. And you can see this. These are databases we have here. This is the one that I have created, DB sample. Let's use that. Show tables in DB sample. So these are databases. There are three databases, sorry, three tables in this database: sample, sample two, and sample called data. Okay. Let me select, sorry. Let me select the data from, select the start from sample call data, some limit, some 10. Let me run this. something wrong. What is that? No database selected. Sorry, here we have to select a DB sample, right? Dot fine. Now you can see there's some sample database here. Call number, enter time from phone number, and this one. So now we shall try to read this data into the data frame. So this database DB sample and this table sample call data. Okay, let's do that. So the database name is DB sample dot sample call data. This is the table name. Fine. So JDBC driver URL. This is the URL and this is the driver. Driver class, user root, password this, and DB table, and finally load. So this has to create a data frame. So whatever the data we have in the table in MySQL, the table must be created as a data frame in the Spark now. Okay, fine. So after that, let's try to print some sample data and schema for it. Df underscore MySQL dot print a schema. Okay, and let's try to print some sample records. Let's show some 10. Fine. Okay, guys, is it fine? Do we have any questions here, guys? Anyone, please let me know.
Can we give multiple options in single option? Can we pass multiple parameters?
Yes, options. We have to use options. We can give multiple parameters. That's possible.
Like here, user root, comma, password. I can give, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, you can give options of URL equal to driver equal to user equal to that. You can pass like that.
Okay.
But this could be the better one. Okay. Because everything passing in a single options, this could be better. Okay. Fine. Now, see this, guys. We are trying to now let us try to run. What is going to happen first? Let's see the issue first. Later we shall try to resolve the issue. What that is? Okay. Let me execute this. So control enter. Invalid syntax. Where is that invalid syntax? Yeah, here we have this one. We have to put continuation colon right file. Now control enter. So it has started executing this code. Let's see what happens now. Whether it reads properly or is there any, will it show any issue? Let's see. So there is some issue with that. Let's see what the issue is. Can you see this, guys? It did not find the driver. Java class not found exception. This driver com MySQL JDBC driver is not there. Then how do you add? We have specified that. We have said, yeah. How to import and where from we have to import?
Similar to Spark session, we have to import driver for JDBC.
You know, Python doesn't contain JDBC drivers.
Okay.
Why? Because Java contains JDBC drivers, right? Java JDBC platform is Java database connectivity. But okay. Python contains Python drivers, not Java drivers.
From Spark.
Yes. So, but internally Spark will make a Java call, not Python call. Why? Because Spark is written in Scala language. Okay. So here we have, generally we think that we need to import the library from Python and we need to use that library. No, well, because Spark doesn't make use of Python library. It makes use of Scala library or Java library internally. So how do we say where from we need to add that? Okay, it's very important that just see here. So if you want to tell, if you want to specify any particular third party library to be added into our application, okay, then we need to add certain configurations. If you want to add something, go with one property called as configuration, spark.jars.packages. Okay, spark.jars.packages. So which package you want? I want a MySQL connector. I want MySQL Java connector. So where from you are going to get it? Where from you will get the jar? So generally we get from Maven repository. All Java libraries are available in almost all the Java libraries are available in the open source central repository called as Maven repository. Okay, let me go there and show you. Just a type here, Maven repository. You go to my, this is the one, and you can search here MySQL hyphen connector. Okay, you can see the first one, MySQL hyphen connector Java. Click on this, and I'm using, you know, guys, I'm using this MySQL version 8 actually, the latest version 8.0 some version. But if you see here, these are the versions of MySQL, but do not use this version because it is not compatible. Just go with 5.1.44 or 45, it will be compatible with it. Okay, I'm going with this one, 5.1.44. these are MySQL versions, and copy this part. You know, when you see Maven or anything, you'll have group ID, artifact ID and version. You can see this, this is called as group ID. I think already who are familiar with Java language, Java programming, they know what is group ID, artifact and version. Okay, so in order to provide some library, we need to add this dependency into our project. Okay, so this is called as group ID, the very first one, and this is called as MySQL, this is called artifact ID, MySQL hyphen connector Java, and this is the version 5.1.44. okay, let's add this. First we need to add group ID. Just remember this, guys, group ID is MySQL, artifact ID is MySQL hyphen connector hyphen Java, and this is the version 5.1.44. okay, let's do that. MySQL is a group ID, and MySQL hyphen connector hyphen Java, CT connector hyphen Java, and colon version 5.1.44. okay, so this is how we need to add a package. Okay, so when we add this, Spark will automatically download the all the jars in this artifact. Okay, so when we specify this, Spark will automatically download the jars corresponding to this artifact. Fine, got it, guys. Okay, if you want to download any jar, if you want to use any jar in Spark application, this is how do it. Okay, fine, dot, that's it, nothing else. Okay, fine, spark.jars.packages, and this is the group ID. Sorry, this is group ID, this is the artifact ID up to here, up to Java, and this is the version. Okay, is it fine, guys? Any questions here? Right, so now it has to work. Let us see what happens. Control enter. I think we need to relaunch. We need to relaunch this this one. Something wrong. Let us see what is the problem. com.mysql.jdbc.driver. Just restart this. Why? Because Spark session has to be recreated, right? The entire Spark driver has to be recreated with this jars. So further, just restart the kernel. So it will be already running with the existing Spark driver. Let us restart it. Nothing else. It will work. Okay, I think it is fine. Now let's execute this. Control enter. Now it will create this Spark driver with these jars, and it will try to establish a connection to MySQL server, and therefrom it is going to read the data. Okay, let's see. So if you want to see what's happening in the background, you can see this case here. Okay, this is where you can see where from you know, this is the command prompt from where we have started the Jupyter notebook. You can see in the back end what's happening. Okay, now I think it has worked. Now let's see, we got it. Okay, this is a syntax, this is a schema, and this is the sample data from it. Is it clear, guys? Do you have any questions in this? Please let me know. In this code, do you have any questions? Please, anyone? Yeah, Ramesh, do you have any questions?
So far, I'm able to follow, Karuna.
Yeah,
I'm good.
Yeah, fine. Yeah, Narendra, any questions?
Sir, no doubt in the code. If you want to read from the Oracle DB, currently we are using Oracle DB in my project. Can we read it,
yes,
right, in the same way? like
Yes.
same
Here the driver is going to, driver will
change.
change and the
Okay.
port number will change and the username password obviously they will change. That's it. But
Okay,
this is
that
the form. This is the form.
that will yeah we'll practice that. That's
Yes,
fine.
it's very simple.
And the connectors just click Oracle in Maven and get the connector for that.
Yeah, let's try. I don't know whether Oracle has driver in this or not. Yes, is there JT, JD, BC, Oracle? There's a is there. Try today.
Okay.
This is, I think it is there. Data store for Oracle. This is a data store. I think some database will be there. Hyphen connector. Yes, it is showing only MySQL. Just make a try. Will you get it or not? But if you don't get it, something, let me show you once. It is also important. The question is important. You know what's happening with what will happen with this is directly the jars will be downloaded from Maven repository. Okay, so Spark can directly download from the Maven repository. Suppose let's say if you know in some companies, you know, they don't allow the firewall of their you know network, their company network doesn't allow the drivers or external libraries to be downloaded directly into their local network. So if you do this, if you do like this, it might not support if you work in your office laptop or office systems or office servers. Then what we have to do then? Yeah, guys, any idea about this? No, why? Because it is my system, right? It is our own system. It will work. Central repository, it has no limitations. But in our company, when we are working, they impose some network restrictions, the content restrictions on the data to be downloaded. So in that case, how do we deal with that? Okay, so in that case, do it like this.
Copy the dependencies and paste somewhere.
Yeah, actually what happens is here, guys, there is one more option here. You can request the network administrator to have that particular jar. Our network administrator or your colleagues or someone, how you can manage it. But if they do not allow you to download, you can add the jars that are present in your local repository. Let's say in your shared folder in your projects in your company's network, then you can add those jars into your project without downloading, without using this option. For that we have one more option. Let me just show you that. Config spark.jars. Sorry. So this is we are going to add. Let's say what I do is go with me MySQL connector Java, and this is the version, right? 5.1.45. Now I go with some 4.4.5. Now what I do is I download this jar 976k. I will download this jar. Yeah, what I do is, so it is in the downloads, right? It is in the downloads. This is the jar. Okay. So you can download. That means I'm downloading here. But if you have already in your local repository or in your company server, central server, if you have the driver, you know, driver in somewhere, you can add that here directly. How you can add is, like we can follow the driver location, sorry, the host location, and you can do that. Downloads and paste this dot jar. That's it, guys. Okay, so if downloading from central repository is not allowed in your company, if something in your machine or somewhere, then you can do like this. Okay, you can download it separately and you can add it to your path. Fine, is it okay? Okay, there are two options available. Any questions in this? Still there are certain options are there. First you practice. If you feel if you have some difficulty or issue, then I will give you the solutions for it. That's it, guys.
Okay.
Yeah, please.
If we don't have any in Maven repository, how do we get it? I mean, for Oracle, we did not find exactly, right? So,
Exactly.
for in that case, how do we give that connectors?
Or suppose, let's say I have my own company. I did not publish my jars on Maven repository. Got it?
Okay.
I did not publish my jars on local Maven repository. I have my own repository where I have
Okay.
my jars. So in that case, you can do something like this. Let's say it is Cloudera repository, direct Cloudera repository. Okay. So this is where index of Cloudera repos. If you click this, or let me show you directly. Okay, that's fine. ORG will have something called as ORG Apache and Spark. Can you see this now? These are all the jars. ORG Apache, and this is the what you call as artifact actually. Spark
Okay.
report, and this is what call as up to from ORG. Generally, you'll find org dot apache dot spark hyphen core. This is what generally we find the path. So this
Okay.
is going to be the URL for it. From here to here, this is going to be the URL of this repository, Cloudera
Okay.
repository. Okay, not the Maven, the pure Cloudera repository. Okay, if you have something like this, okay. So these companies, large companies, what they do is they maintain their the jars or all the libraries in their own repository in their servers. They don't maintain in Maven. So in that case, how do you add the library? This is how you are going to add the library set. So you have to specify where in which repository those libraries are available. So here, in this case, what is the repository that we are telling to Spark that this is from where you have to download the jars? From Maven repository, right?
Maven. Okay.
So yeah, if our library is not available in Maven, else in some other let's say Cloudera repository. Okay, in that case,
Okay.
you need to specify the URL of this. How we are going to
Okay.
specify the URL of this repository in the application is very simple. Add one more config. Spark dot, sorry, Spark dot jars dot repositories, and what are the repository we have here? Just copy this. I'm copying this repos and paste it here. Okay. So whenever we give these jars, first the Spark will try in local repo, sorry, central repository, that is Maven. If it doesn't
Okay.
find in local Maven repository, then it will search for the libraries in this drive, this repository. So likewise, you can
Okay.
mention any number of repositories followed separated by comma. You can specify one more repository, one more any number of repositories you can mention.
Okay, so it will keep searching until it finds one or
If it
okay.
doesn't find, it will throw error that I don't find this particular jar file or some class file or something like that. Otherwise, it will work. It will download
Okay.
automatically from that, and it will work. Okay.
And we have to specify that connectors, right? Which one? Like in the first one, we have mentioned like
Yes,
MySQL connector.
yes, compulsory. We should know what is the driver
Okay.
name. Generally, that will be given if you are working on Oracle. In the documentation, they will provide you what is the driver for, what is the driver to connect to some database or something. They will provide you. It is not a big deal.
Okay.
That's
Okay.
why the documentation. So
Okay.
for
Yeah,
now, I'm
thanks.
just commenting these two. Okay, is it fine? Right. Now, this is the data we have. So yesterday we have some issues with that, right? What is that called as some filter operation, right? So let's see that MySQL dot filter. It's very simple, guys. So there is a conflict with single quotes and double quotes. Why? Because in Python, to represent a string, we can either use single quotes or double quotes. This is same as this one. Let's say some Python. So this is same as what? Keeping the same thing in single quotes. Both are same. So there's a conflict. So we should not use two continuously consecutive single quotes or consecutive double quotes. That will be an issue. So it cannot interpret properly. So that is because of that reason it was throwing error. So let's say if you here, if you want to add some, if you want to compare with status now, if you want to filter based on status, equal to again one more single quotes, what's of dropped. If we give like this, it will throw an error. Why? Because it will not be able to parse it properly. Because here we are going to get two continuously, the single quotes here. So it will not understand which is the string, what's happening here. So it understand, it will think that some string is missing in between the single quotes. It will make assumption like that. So it will not understand properly. So in order to make it clear, just to put this in double quotes and put the entire thing in single quote. Got it now? See this. This one. And this entire stuff is in single quotes. Got it, guys? Or you can put the entire stuff in double quotes and keep this dropped in single quotes. Either you follow that or this. But do not follow same convention, same, embedding this quote, single quote, double quotes, same. Okay, it is going to throw an error because of non-parsing properly. Okay, fine. Let me show you that, show some file.
So double equal of it, sir.
Some error, where is the error? Jar, will have a jar. Yeah, here we have a like fine. MySQL connector, yeah. Then what is the issue? Is again throwing errors. Right.
We did not mention the Maven repository path directly. If we give that, it will search in Maven only.
Yes, it will search in Maven. Okay. It is working on this. Now you can see a dropped. Only the status is equal to dropped. Okay. And if you want to include multiple conditions, let us say if you want to filter based on multiple conditions, that you can use or, you can use AND, do the connect conjunctions. So I use one more condition here, AND. This is one condition, and I add one more condition, something like some from a phone underscore number equal to. Again, put it in double quotes. Okay, you are putting this in single quotes. So you put the keyword that we are searching for in double quotes. So let me just copy this and paste it here. Okay, let me run this. You got it. Okay, so two conditions will be satisfied. Then only the output is going to be evaluated. Is it fine, guys? Do you have any questions here?
The single quotes and double quotes, we can interchange it. I mean, for
yes,
status,
yes.
We can.
Exactly. Okay. Let me show you that. So I'm putting in single quotes. Yeah. Okay. Now let me run. It will work. Okay. You can change, interchange these two. Double quotes and single quote, but see that they do not occur consecutively. Okay, so that will understand,
okay,
that something is missing in between that part.
Okay.
Okay. Is it clear, guys, about adding jars, adding connectors, and everything? So just do
yes.
practice. If you don't get it, we shall discuss in the next session. That's about it. Okay. Fine. So similarly, now we are reading from a JDBC. that is MySQL. Is it possible to write the same thing to some JDBC, that is to MySQL, reading write? Now, can we write it to that MySQL? That is possible. It is possible to write to MySQL. Okay. So what I do is, let us read some data. Just let me comment all this. I'll create one more data frame, and from local file system we shall read some data frame and we shall write it into MySQL. Okay, so df underscore local equal to spark driver dot read dot format. There is some JSON file is there, JSON dot load users. There's a file called as companies.json. Does one question, guys? I think you have already experienced in RDBMS, right? I think you have experience in RDBMS, most of you. Do we have structured data type in MySQL or Oracle? Structured data type. In programming language, we have structure, right? Struct.
Yes.
Do we have a structured data type in MySQL or Oracle? I'm not that good at MySQL or RDBMS. That's what I'm asking you. Okay, let's see. Let's see. Let's see. Let's see. Don't worry. Let's see. df underscore local dot show. Let me write some sample records. So now we are reading this JSON as a data frame from local file system, and we shall try to write this data frame into RDBMS, that is MySQL. Okay. It is still working on that. Don't get panic, guys. Okay. It will take some time depending upon this data size. We'll give you a result. The data set is very, very huge. There are many, many columns, guys. What we shall do first, we shall try to print the schema first. Dot print the schema. Yeah, this is the schema of it. Now I would like to save this entire data frame to RDBMS, guys. How do you do that? I would like to save this entire data frame to RDBMS. You can do it. Also, what I do is underscore everything, whatever we have here, I will just copy this stuff. Yeah. And paste it, but it's not read.
Right.
Let me just comment all this now, because it is going to create all this. Fine. So which data frame that we are trying to write? Df underscore local dot write dot format. Okay, write dot format JDBC, and everything is same. And as what table you are trying to create? I'm trying to create some companies data. Companies table. So this table need not be created in MySQL, remember guys. The table structure or table schema also need not be created. Everything will be created. Okay, need just the database has to be there.
Data table with that name, it will append to the table. If it is not there, it will create. That's it, right?
Yes. So there's an option here when we're trying to write into somewhere, some file or some RDBMS anywhere, we can follow two modes of writing, either overwrite or append. You got my point, right? Either we are interested in overwriting that existing data. If we are giving the same name, there's a chance of no conflict, right? Whether to overwrite or append. So we can provide that option, whether to overwrite or append. I will show you after this. I will try to show you. First, let us work directly. We don't have this table now, as of now. Let us try. And save. Finally, we are not going to load it. Now we are going to save it. Fine. Is it clear about this? Df underscore local write format. And before that, I'm just commenting this. So we're creating a data frame. We're writing the data frame into MySQL. Okay, just write format JDBC and save. That's it. Everything is fine. Okay, let's run this now. Let's see what happens. So I think there are some issues. Yeah. Can you see this, guys? That's what I'm asking here. I tried with yesterday. Cannot get a JDBC type for struct of void string. So is it possible to do we have data type struct actually in MySQL? That's what I asked you.
No.
I think we don't have, right? It has struct is a user defined type. So I think user defined data types are not allowed, not supported. It supports only predefined types. So that is the reason it doesn't allow it. So in that case, how do you load the data then?
Into MySQL data.
Yeah. Let's select some columns which do not, which are not structures, and let's try to do that. What I do is, before that, let's see what are the some columns. Sorry, what are some columns whose type is not struct, and let us choose only those columns and shall write into MySQL for now, just for understanding purpose. Okay. Yeah, this is the schema here we have. There are many columns are there. ID is a struct, underscore ID is a struct. So acquisition is also a struct. All are mostly are structs only. Yeah, here we have some created it. It is a string. Crunchbase underscore URL is also some string. So here we have some columns are there. Let's use those columns. Created it, and I will use only two columns for now here. Df underscore local 2 equal to df underscore local dot select. I'm selecting only some columns, not all the columns, only some columns. Select of created underscore URL comma Crunchbase
created at
fine. Just you can add any number of columns. Later we will also see in the use cases. In the next week we shall also see how to deal with this structured data types. We cannot just skip the data, right? We cannot just skip the data. Somehow we have to move. If there is a requirement of loading the data into JD, MySQL or Oracle, we cannot just skip the data. We have to find a solution to write the data into that. How we do that? So there are certain options, are there certain ways of doing it is there. But for now, just understand, just go with this. How we are writing into JDBC. Later in the use case of discussion, I will explain you how to do all this. Okay, fine. Now what I'm doing is, from the actual data frame df underscore local, I'm creating a new data frame with two columns. So I'm created it and the Crunchbase URL. Now I will try to load this data frame into that MySQL part. Control X and add somewhere here. Yeah. After this, let me paste this here. Yeah, okay. So after data frame, I have to copy it itself only. Told me. And after that, now write data local 2. Okay. Is it fine, guys? After df local, we are selecting only two columns. And after that, we are writing df local 2 into MySQL. Okay, it should work fine now. Let's see what happens. So I give the command. Is it working fine? So first let me clear all the output. Yeah, it is clear. Now, just to understand that the process success or not, I will write some success, a statement called a success. Yeah, let me run now. It is throwing the same error again. I think one more issue. What is that? Cannot resolve created it crunch base URL. Don't we have these columns? We have, right? No, yeah. They were there. I think these must be in a list. Yeah, this should work fine now. Again, some issue. What is that? Cannot resolve created it crunch base. You given input columns phone number, updated it. Naya, unnai kadandi. We have those columns, right? Created underscore it and the crunch base URL. We have these columns. Why come it is not showing that? One second. Instead of doing this, we shall just try to print df local to. Df underscore local 2 dot some show some file. Just try to print it. If it is working fine, then we shall try to write the data. An error occurred while calling cannot resolve columns.
Square bracket this thing.
Where? Here? I think we can pass them directly also. Let's see what happens. I think this has to be the process. This has to be done. Yeah, we got it now. So we missed the colons here, single quotes here. Now that's fine. Is it okay now? We shall write these two. So now we are writing this. So now I'm writing df local to this RDBMS. Okay, let's write that. So after writing this, if it prints success, that means that the data frame is written successfully into that RDBMS. We shall verify that. So we have to see success here. Yeah, success printed here. Let's go to RDBMS and see what are databases we have. Show tables. Yeah, already we have that command here. Show tables in DB sample. Here also to control enter to display the tables. You can see that. What is the companies? We have the table called as companies. Select star from sample data from the just give companies here. You got the data, right? So what are the data that we have there in the data frame that we got here now? Is it clear, guys? Where is to read the data from RDBMS, write to RDBMS, it's very, very simple. The syntax is simple, the same read and writing, everything will be same. There we use the Spark read, Spark driver read. Here we write data frame dot write. And we need to add the jar, the class. So we have to mention the driver name. And we have to mention the jar part. That's it. Everything will be fine. Is it clear, guys? Okay. Do you have any questions? Yeah, perfect. Right. Now, we shall try to read a new file format called as, I think now till now we have seen what are the different file formats we have discussed about. We have seen CSV, right? Yes. TSV also, that means the CSV with the tab as a delimiter. JSON we worked with, Parquet. I think, did we work with ORC?
No.
I think we have worked with ORC. And
No, we didn't see that ORC.
JDBC. ORC, it is very simple. If you have ORC file, we can read and we can write it also. I think I forgot one thing here. Someone asked that if we have the data, data will be whether overwritten or appended. So we shall check one here. How many rows are there in this table now? Select the count of star from DB sample dot companies. So here we have 18801. Okay, 18801 records are there. Okay, now we shall try to write the date, try to execute this code again. Okay, see what happens. Let us see what happens. By default, what will happen? And if you want to go with our customized writing, we have to do it. Let's do that once again. I'm writing the data frame again into the same table. What will happen? Let's see. So it may throw an error that table already exists. You can see that table already exists. You can observe this error here. So we have to mention some mode of writing if the table is already existing. Okay. So the mode can be, you can choose the mode of writing. What is that mode? Either you can choose append mode or you can choose overwrite mode. I choose append. Okay. Fine. Is it fine, guys? Right. Now let us run this again. It has to print success. If yes, it has printed success. So I think the process is done now. So if it is append, already we have how many? 18,000, right? Again, 18,000 records must be written into the table. So total we get around some 36,000. Okay. Let's run this query again. Select the count of star. So we can see the figure here, 37,602. That means the data is overwritten. Got it? So we have two options: overwrite and append. Whichever we want, we can use it, depending upon our.
Yeah. So I want only the updated records. I don't want to load my, again the all the records. So what we need to do?
That we have to check in the data frame only. We can't do that in RDBMS. That entire processing that we have to do in this only. So I will show you a simple example. Let us say you are writing data daily into some RDBMS. Let us say your job is to write the data daily, right? So whatever the data I get today, that data has to be written into what called as RDBMS. Tomorrow I will get some more data, right? Tomorrow I will get some more data. So that data has to be, only that data has to be written into that RDBMS, not the entire data again. Okay, so with this operation, the entire data is going to be written again, but I want only some data to be written, some data in the sense only updated, today's data or only updated data I want to write. So updation, how it is going to make that, we have to specify by using one column partition, one column with partition. I think let me show you. One second. I will write something like this. Timestamp. Fine. I create one more database here. That example I will show you tomorrow, Narendra. Okay, I have to get some your data.
Okay,
sir. Data set ready chase pony. I will show that.
Okay,
because
sir.
I don't have the data set now.
Okay, sir.
I have to prepare a data set. I don't have the data set right now. Now, I will try to show you that how to read XML files. So remember why I'm stressing particularly on XML is, guys, here Spark has a library to parse all these. So when we have installed that Spark, PySpark, or simply Spark Shell or anything, Spark has the inbuilt library to parse CSV, JSON, Parquet, ORC, and JDBC. But it doesn't have a library to parse with XML and Avro. I think the latest version has included the option of reading the data from Avro, but I'm not sure. I did not check it. I have to check it. And it will not have till 2.2 versions. I know that XML version, XML files and Avro files. Spark will not have a live direct library to do this. Okay, so we need to add again third part library. We need to include third part artifacts to read this XML and Avro files. Got my point here? So how we are going to do that? The same thing, guys. Very simple. Again, we have those libraries in the Maven repository. We have those libraries in Maven repository. So if we have Maven repository, what we have to do? We have to again add the packages here. So now, along with the MySQL package, now we have to add XML package also, XML library information. So what we do is I go with again Maven repository. So Databricks is the company, okay, which is providing these libraries. So search for Databricks, we can see Spark CSV, Spark Avro, Spark CSV. You may ask some question. You said that already Spark has the inbuilt library to read CSV files. We have seen also, right? So I have seen some examples also. But why it has the Spark-CSV again? Databricks is Spark 1 versions. I'm telling you 1.x versions. They don't have readymade library to parse CSV. That is the reason they have provided Spark CSV for those versions, not for Spark 2 versions. Remember that. Okay. Now we have Spark Avro and Spark XML. First, let me go with Spark XML first. So just to scroll down, you will have Spark XML. This is where you have Spark XML. Okay. Spark hyphen XML. Click on this. And you can choose the latest version, not an issue. And the Scala version 2.11. And these are the libraries. So this is the group ID, artifact ID, and version 0.4.1. Fine. So com.databricks, this is the group ID. And this is the artifact ID, spark-x1-2.11 and 0.4.1. Okay, let's add this. So com.databricks, this is the group ID, and spark-xml_2.11 and colon, what is the version? 4041. Version is 041. So as it is already in Maven repository, it will download automatically from it. Got it? Clear, guys? Group ID followed by artifact ID followed by the version. That's it. Okay, just restart it. Restart the kernel. Why? Because we have to restart the Spark driver. Just restart it. Go to kernel, restart and clear output. It will just restart, nothing else. I think it is restarted. Now let's run this code. Even we don't need this now. So let's run this. So we have to print success, then we shall try to read the XML file. So if you see in the background what's happening, this is what's happening in the background, guys. Actually, if you see this, okay, you can see this something here. Spark XML is added as a dependency. You can observe here. It is resolving the dependency. It is downloading the dependency. Everything is happening in the background. Okay. Fine. It is printed success. That means it is working fine. The library has added. Now we shall try to read XML file. df_xml equal to spark dot read dot format of XML dot load. There's some XML file here on desktop of my machine. There's a file you can see in the last. I will open with this notepad++. This is the JSON record, the XML record, guys. Okay, XML data. So the name of the file is XML sample dot XML. Okay, let me just try with that. XML sample dot XML. Okay, and df underscore XML dot show. So let me run this now. Spark driver, right? Spark driver, I think. Right. Control enter. Why is taking this much time? Some file. Yeah, one thing, let me do like this. Let me print success also here. Also print something so to understand that it is working fine or not. Okay, let me print. Okay, I will run it now again.
So if it is already running, how to stop that the running program or command?
Directly we can't stop, only this one particular one. We need to restart this interrupt.
Okay.
We can
call it initially. You have just written dot show, so it will try to execute completely, and again you have written a file. So how will the first one stop and start this?
It will be aborted and it will be started again.
Oh.
I think some issue. Load example sample dot. Sorry, I mentioned the path correctly. Sorry, I forgot. Users. It is on the desktop, right? XML sample. Fine. It should be fine now.
Users, yes, should be smaller. Users.
No. It is not case sensitive. It will work. It is not an issue. But why it is not working?
Something.
It is not trying to read at all. Let me do one thing. Let me restart it. So when you restart it again, it will show something. It's not responding. Yeah. Restart and clear output. Got stuck here. What is the problem? Just a second, guys. Every time it is showing some issue with me. There are some memory issues or memory constraints. A Spark will stop, like, you know, normally. Don't worry about that. It's not a big deal. Just restart it, everything will work fine. Just I'm stopping this, I'll restart it. Just restart it. Scroll down. Python, PySpark, notebook. Yeah, here we have PySpark notebook. Yeah, here we have it. Let me run this once again. Can you see what's happening in the background? This is what's happening. I think it is fine now. Yes, it has to print success. Then we can proceed, go with this cell. It is printed success. Now we shall run this cell, this particular cell. Okay, control enter. Yeah, this is some got some response now. Can you see something? We got empty data frame. This is empty actually. It's trying to print something, but we got empty. What could be the reason? And we got printed, it has printed as okay. So the problem or the reason here it is, can you see the guys XML file here? So when you see this XML, you know, we have tags, the data will be embedded between the tags, right? Here we have number, contacts, contact, name, all this. Okay, so the data will be embedded in the tags. So we have to tell from which tag you would like to pull the data from. So or from under which tag you would like to pull the data from, that we have to pass. You got my point here? So if you want to pull the data from an XML file, we have to tell what is the tag, what is the tag name from which you have to pull the file. Why? Because the data will be nested tags, right? Tag under tag, tag under tag. Okay, so we have to exactly tell that. So now I'm passing this
in
content.
A scenario we do not know the how the file is, we are, if we are getting it from some server location, we cannot see the file, right?
No, so we'll have case, you know, we'll have an totally external tag will be there, an external tag will be there. No, it has to start with something, it has to start with some tag, XML file. Okay, it won't start directly, it has to start with some XML tag. So
it will start, but if we do not know where it started, like if we do not have access to open the file, but we have only read permissions to that file, and we need to extract what is there in that file. So in that case, how to extract? Here, this file is on desktop, so we are able to see and open. If it is there in some server location, how to know which tag and all, how to write that?
You know, one thing I can tell you, at least we'll have some read permissions, right? When we have some data directly,
yes.
At least we'll have some, we might have write permissions, but we have read permissions. So okay. If there is something wrong with the data, just not at all, even having a look at the data, so nobody will ask us to do directly the processing of the data. At least we'll get some sample data of it. So we can go through that. Do that tracking, okay? It's not a big deal. So you can choose any tag. Now I'm choosing this contact, or you can choose contacts. So what are all the tags that I have under this contact? They will, the data will be retrieved as the tables, sorry, as the columns into my data frame. I choose this contact as the row tag. So hope we have to tell that is of option of, we need to add one option. There are several options are there, guys. There are several options are there. I will let you know in the use cases. just let me make you to understand how do we work with, how do we read these files. So later in the use cases, we'll explore more on this, various issues, various possibilities of reading and writing everything, which we'll see again there. Okay. So this simply mention option row tag of contact. Okay. Now run this again. Now you can see whatever all that we have under this contact, all the tags that we get there, communications and this. And if you print the schema, it will be clear, more clear. But because we have nested tags there, let me just scroll down. You can see this. So under contact we have communications. Under communications we have communication. And in that communication is an array, and in that we have many elements again, struct of email ID, number, type, and name. We have all this. Got it? So if you want to trace only particular columns from this, let's say email ID, number, and type and name as separate columns. Now you can see this communications is passed as only a single column. But in that we have again communication, in that we have again email ID, number, and type. Then how do you pass separately email ID, number, type, and name as you know what, separate columns? How can we do that? So it's simple. Let me give a try here. Df underscore XML dot select. So what is that you are trying to select? Communications. Under that I want communication, and in that I have email ID. Okay, this could be one column I'm interested in looking for, and one more column will be number. You know, we don't have that much flexibility with XML. Okay, we don't have that much flexibility. Why? Because nested tags will be there. Email ID and type, and one more column. Here we have name. Name is directly under this here. This one, okay. Directly we can choose name. Dot show. Awesome 10 or 5. Is it clear, guys? How we are doing this? Nested echo communications dot communication dot email. And the communication dot number, email, communication dot type, and finally name. You can pass name directly. Why? Because this is the hierarchy here. Directly you can pass name. Now we can run this. We shall try this. Let us see if we got that out properly or not. Yes, we got it. Now we can say this. This is the email ID, number, type, and name. You got it, guys? Email ID, number, type, and name. Is it fine, guys? Do you have any question in this? This is how we can extract you know what, the internal or the nested tags data by using a dot operator between each hierarchy level of hierarchy. You can just extract those columns. Fine, clear, guys? Any questions from anyone, please?
We can save this output in separate data frame, right? And we can separate data frame, yeah. And
yes, you can do that. Df underscore XML 2. You can call it like this, and you can print it. Did it show from here? And you can write directly. XML. You can do that. Okay, it's not a big deal. Give me whatever you want. Just I'm commenting this. I'm printing only this one, like this. Okay.
Now we structure, right? Now we can use this one, right? The XML 2 data frame.
Yes, we can use XML 2 for our processing, or we can write somewhere. You can some operations on this.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah. Any questions, guys? Still not here. Yeah, before that I would like to try to show you something called as, you know what, partitioning. What do you mean by partitioning, guys? Partitioning.
Grouping the data based on some tag.
Yes. Based on some column, based on the unique values of some column, right? So now, just now, okay, I will try to show the next one more example tomorrow, but today I will show you some what partitioning is exactly. Now, if you go with MySQL, see this, guys, this is the not companies, one more table was there, right? What was call log data, call data, sample call data, call data, okay. So if you see here, here we have three columns, right? Sorry, three values of the status: dropped, failed, and success. I would like to partition the data based on status. I would like to save this data in somewhere, in some RDBMS or in some SDFS or local file system. Now I will read from this local file, sorry, MySQL. And I will try to partition the data and I will write into some file system, or we can read from file system, we can write into MySQL with partition, we can do both, it's not a big deal, okay. So now what I'm going to do is I'm trying to read this table from this MySQL, and I will try to partition based on the status. Let's see how the output will be created as, okay, let's do that. Sample call data. Remember the table name is sample call data. Yes, this is the table name. Okay, we are reading sample call data. Now after this, what is that we are trying to do is we shall try to write this data by partitioning based on status. Df underscore MySQL dot write dot format, you can mention what format you want. Which is the format you would like to write? I would like to write with ORC extension, ORC format dot partition by. Partition by, which column you would like to partition the data by? How many columns we can use for partitioning, guys? Only one or more? How many columns we can use for partitioning? We can use multiple columns, right? Partition by one column, under again partition one more column. We can have, but we can use multiple columns in the partition by. But for now, I'm using only one partition. Multiple partitions, I will show you tomorrow how we deal with it. Okay. And partition the status data and save. That's it. So I call it as partition output. Got it, guys? Okay. And finally, I will write some print writing done successfully. Okay, this is what I'm writing. Why? Because once writing is complete, it doesn't throw anything, any message that writing is complete or anything. That's what I'm writing, this print statement. So MySQL, after creating MySQL from the table sample call data, we are writing into that. Okay, I'm writing onto desktop partition output. Let's run this now. Let's see what happens. So it has to print return successfully. Yeah, you can see here writing done successfully. And now let's go and verify on the desktop. This is a desktop partition. This is, you can see one directory called as partition output here. Open this one. Can you see this, guys, here? Status equal to dropped, status equal to failed, and status equal to success. So why we got three directories? Why? Because, you know, we have partitioned the data by status. So this directory is going to contain only status record. That what is the format we have chosen? ORC. So now the data is written in ORC format. Okay. Similarly for failed, and similarly for success. ORC file. Clear, guys? It's very simple, guys. Very, very simple. If you want to partition by multiple columns, let's say I would like to partition by status as well as what is another column? Let's say one more column called as What is the another column we have? Some from phone number one. Just let us check here. Start time is there, from phone number is there, status to phone number is there. Just I will stay as former by start time. Okay. I will also partition by using start underscore time. So partition status and start underscore time. Now I change the path of this output to, let me call it as partition output to. Now we are trying to partition by two columns, status and start time. Okay, let's do this now. Let's run this. Let's see what happens, it works or not. So partition will obviously take some time. Why? Because it has to segregate the entire data. It has to look for the unique fields. It has to write it. So it will take certain time depending upon the number of rows. It is still working on that. Well, because the number of records are, I don't know how many number of records are there in that.
Since that is running, I just have a curious
question. Yeah, here. Yeah. Please go on.
Okay. So, like example, in Oracle or somewhere, right? In RDBMS, if you're doing partition, if there is a short time, we may have date and followed by some microseconds and all nanoseconds, right? So, we just want to take the only date column, like YY by MMDD. So, we can do all that here also, right?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. We can do all that. We can do all that. We can do that. Generally, you know, for small amounts of data, generally we don't go with Spark at all. If there is huge, large amounts of data, then only Spark has some purpose there. If the data is huge, then only Spark has some purpose. That too, running on a cluster, not on a single node, running on a cluster. Okay, remember that point. I will show you how to run the jobs on the cluster also. Now, till now we have been working only in this one. I will try to show you how to run the applications on a cluster. What are the various clusters supported for running Spark for jobs? Nowadays, I think it is it still running? Let me just wait. Yeah, that output is created. I think it is still writing. It is working on that. So. I told you something in the beginning in the demo session. Spark application can run on different types of clusters. One is YARN cluster, Mesos cluster, standalone cluster, and from Spark 2.3 onwards, they have introduced one more cluster called as Kubernetes. Have you heard about this, guys? This was a product of Google actually. This was a product of Google. Now they have open sourced in 2014. And now this is a product, Kubernetes. It is something like, you know, Dockers and containers. Hello? Dockers
yeah, we can,
and
we can.
Yeah. It is something like it uses containers for running the jobs, containers. Like, you know, like what Docker. I think most of the people have idea about Docker. So it is something like that. Okay, it uses of containers. So this is going to be popular in future. Not YARN, not Mesos, or not standalone. This will be the popular one in future. Okay, so try to, I will give you how you, I will explain you even how Kubernetes works, how we have to install it, how we can test run it. I will try to show you that also. Okay, don't worry, but remember that K8s, it is called as simply in shortcut, it's short term, it's called a K8s, that is K followed by 8 characters followed by S. That's the meaning of this Kubernetes K8s. Okay, I will explain that. It is supportable and it is still under experimentation only in Spark, not yet fully supported, not yet stabilized. Okay, meanwhile, by the end of our course, it may the Spark might release a stable version of this Kubernetes support. Then we'll try to learn about it also. Okay, I think it is still running, guys. Why? Because there are, I think, there are many records are there. Just let me check how many rows are there actually in this sample call data.
18,000 or something.
18,000 na? Kaadan kota. 18,000 inko table idi.
So okay.
2 lakhs na hai. 2 lakhs 10,000 13. I think the timestamps are totally different. And the time, start time anedi okokadaniki chaala unnattundi almost they are in thousands
and lakhs. Yeah, the seconds also. So every row will be partitioned.
Yeah, it will take some time. It's no problem. This is very simple. This is how we can do. You know, we have been okay, that's fine. We shall continue the next part tomorrow. Continuation of this. Meanwhile,